Turn with me in your Bibles, if you will, at this time, to Luke chapter 2, verse, it says 28 through 32. I'm going to back up. Sorry, Pastor. I want to back up to verse 27.
Amen.
I hate starting a sentence, mid-sentence.
Yes.
Verse 27, Luke chapter 2, verse 27 through 32 in the New King James Version. And it says, "So he came by the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him in his arms, blessed God, and said, 'Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and glory to your people of Israel.'" May the Lord place a blessing on the reading of his word and the praising of his name today.
Thank you, Brother Roger, for reading to us those beautiful words of Scripture. Thank you, Sister Beth, for coming to our rescue since I was learning how to patiently drive between a couple of churches and had that sneaking suspicion we would not be here on time. And we appreciate you coming to our rescue this morning. Happy Sabbath. It is so good to see each of you here. Can I try an alternate version since we're just a day away? Merry Christmas. It is great to come into God's presence and to get to worship and praise Him. And while we realize Jesus was not born on December 25, there are some powerful connections that I pray God will speak to our hearts through the precious gift of a baby who was named Jesus. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, in these next few moments, I would ask, Lord, please somehow make me disappear. We want to hear your voice. We're asking that it would be your Spirit that would make your word come alive and leave us forever changed by a glimpse of our Savior. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Brother Roger read to us from the book of Luke, and we'll come back to Luke. But I would invite you to travel with me to a later book in the New Testament. The little book of Titus, still chapter 2, Titus chapter 2, and as we begin reading about verse 11, we'll have a quiz after we read it, so please listen closely. Luke, we'll come back to it, but Titus chapter 2, verse 11, Titus 2, verse 11. "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works." Ready for the quiz? As we read these verses, do you see tucked in them the first advent or birth or coming of Jesus? You spot it in there? It's really quiet. Let me double check. Let's look closely for just a minute. "For the grace of God that bringeth," what's the next word? salvation hath appeared to what? All men. I have a problem in my backyard. Anybody here feed the birds? Maybe you can give me some advice after the service what to do with this problem. At any rate, I've got a pole, got the bird feeders, and got one that is soot, and some birds like to hang there and peck on it, and then there's a couple that have the sunflower seeds and other things, and cardinals and other critters, other birds love to get them. But birds are messy eaters. You notice that? that there's bird seed and other things scattered all over, but the Lord provided a precious solution. There's a family of doves that hang out in the backyard, and they're all the time down on the ground pecking, and it's just amazing. It's so neat. Love to listen to them with that beautiful song. And here's my problem. In addition to the wonderful birds, I looked out one day and I saw this four-legged critter. Fuzzy, lots of fur. And it goes meow. Everybody know what I'm talking about? I didn't know that cats like birdseed. I should have talked to Miss Ruth. She's looking at me like they don't. Be forewarned, that cat didn't come for the bird seed and the bird feeder. Why is that cat there? It's got its eye on those birds and it's thinking, yummy, yummy. I've seen some feathers that make me think maybe it was successful. I wished I knew what to do about it. But I read a story this week by a little fella named Nathan. Maybe I should call him Simeon, but maybe I should have named him Isaiah. But the story as I read it, supposedly a true story, the little boy's name was Nathan, and he had the same problem, except he had some really creative solutions. He decided to write a big sign. Warning! Birds watch out for cat. And he started to prop it up outside, and then he said, wait a minute, there's a problem with that solution, isn't there? They don't read. It's not going to do any good. So then he got another bright idea. He said, I'm going to just go outside, and I'm going to sit beside the bird feeder, and I'm going to scare away the cat. I'm going to warn the birds. Well, you know what that did. The birds saw this two-legged, what they thought was a two-legged monster, and they didn't come to the bird feeder anymore. So he said, what do I do to warn the birds and not scare them away? As I'm reading that story, it suddenly dawned on me, wait a minute. God had a very similar problem. Because this world has an enemy. The Bible describes him as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And yet, God is the remedy, and he wants to save his people. So what does he do? In fact, if you travel with me back to the very first book of the Bible, we listen in to that promise that was made way back in the Garden of Eden that Jesus would come and conquer. Notice Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. I will put enmity between thee, speaking to Satan, in the form of the serpent, speaking to the serpent, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, God's people. And between thy seed, the followers of Satan, and her seed, the followers of God, it shall bruise thy head. Satan is a conquered, defeated foe. Good news. And thou shalt bruise his heel. Jesus would pay an incredible price. Yet this week, as I was studying, ran across a fascinating manuscript written back in 1886 by a lady named Ellen White. She had been asked to preach, and you'd never guess what day it was that she was asked to preach. December 26. What's today, by the way? December 26. You can guess why it caught my attention. And she's over in Switzerland, of all places. What a snowy, beautiful place to spend Christmas. And she's asked to preach that next day, and there's 400 people out in the audience. She's talking to a translator, and her opening scripture was Titus chapter 2. I would not have thought of it as describing the mission statement of Jesus. And yet, here we're reading from Titus. Now we're reading from Genesis. But listen to Isaiah. Listen to Isaiah chapter 53. Notice, the whole chapter's powerful. But notice verse 5. Isaiah 53 and verse 5. The Bible says, He, speaking of Jesus, was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon Him, and with His stripes we are healed. Yes, Jesus was born as a baby. Yes, He grew and ultimately suffered and died on the cross for my sins. Oh, but praise God, He's not still in a grave, tucked away lifeless. He is alive and at the right hand of the throne of God. Our advocate. I quote from that sermon, Christ saw that it was impossible for man to overcome and become a conqueror in his own strength. It would be well for our minds to be carried back to the time when the Son of God was made flesh. You ready to take that journey? Behold Him in the manger. Remember how the angel of the Lord appeared in great glory to the shepherds. In fact, let's travel to Luke. Let's go to Luke chapter 2. Let's listen in on some very familiar verses, but let's notice what the scripture says. If we started, I like Brother Roger's point. It's nice to grab the context of what we're reading. So let's just grab, starting with the first verse, Luke chapter 2, verse 1. The Bible says, it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that most of the world should be taxed. Oh, thank you. Please, please check what I say and make sure that it's what the Bible says. It was that all the world should be taxed. And if we scan on down for the sake of time, notice it in verse 6. Notice it says, so it was that while they, Mary and Joseph, were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And verse 7 explains, she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. The Bible doesn't tell us what color swaddling clothes are. But somehow in my imagination, I picture baby Jesus wrapped up in cloths of white. They may have been very, very stained and off-white. I wasn't there. The Bible doesn't explicitly say, but I picture baby Jesus wrapped in white. And the other day, Sister Retta standing up there on Gaither Mountain, watching the snow come down and wrap the ground. It all turned white, Brother Richie. It was white on the cars. It was white on the trees. It was white on the road. Thank I was so thankful for people with four-wheel drive. That's all I'm going to say. I'm thankful for four-wheel drives. But you know, there's a Bible verse that I can't look at snow without thinking of. You know it? Isaiah 1:18. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Can you help me say it? Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Notice if we keep reading here in Luke 2, the Bible says there was a country, shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. And the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, what'd they say? Verse 14, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, good will toward men. But you'll notice we jumped over that precious verse, verse 12. We can't skip it. This shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe in a palace wrapped in... Oh, I need to double check. Thank you for catching that. It wasn't a glorious palace. It wasn't a magnificent mansion. It wasn't a nice, warm, fuzzy, cozy one piece that he could snuggle in. What was it? He was born in a stable. He, you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And yet with this sign given and with this angel choir singing, can you picture the shepherds in verse 15? It came to pass as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go into Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. What a privilege that here they get the message from heaven. And the one angel alone, the whole choir wants to get in on the action. Notice verse 16, they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told them. Oh, but there's another part to the story. And again, I'm quoting from this sermon that was given. There were also wise men who had been guided from the east by a star to the place where the child Jesus had been. They came to worship Him. They brought their gifts to Jesus. Gold, frankincense, myrrh. This oblation offered by these men who were neither Jews nor Gentiles, but were men who had lived up to the best light that they had. They had been searching the scriptures, and as they traced the lines of prophecy, they ascertained about the time that Christ would be born. I hope you're hearing some common themes, because the message that you and I need today comes from the Word of the living God. Nothing transforms our lives. Nothing brings peace and comfort. Nothing brings hope. Nothing is so good to share as the wonderful words of life. And here, even as we remember the birth of Jesus the first time, the reality is this is the last Sabbath in 2020. I don't know where the time has gone. The next time we come together on a Sabbath is going to be 2021. And while that gets us closer to Jesus coming than ever before, it's also a time to stop and take inventory of Ross's heart. I shouldn't tell this story, but I'm being transparent. Just this morning, and it's so cool how kids and different people choose to come to church. Kid came to the Marshall Church on his brand new hoverboard. Or is that what they're called? These two little rolly things that you stand on, nothing to hold on to, but it rolls you forward, it rolls you backwards. And I looked at him and I said, "Wow, do you think I should try it?" And he looked at me, and he didn't have to say a word. All over his face was, "It's my hoverboard, not yours." And so about that time, some other church family came in. We were talking about it. And I said, you know, he was so nice. He didn't say these words, but he looked at me and suggested I needed to go on a diet first. And the person standing next to me said, "Is that what he really said?" And the kid looked at, shook his head. He said, "Pastor, you're supposed to tell the truth. Don't be making up stories. That's not a good example to the young man." And he was right. So the Lord thumped me and said, "You need to apologize to this young man that you embellished the story that wasn't what was true." So I did. And I had to say, "Lord, forgive me. Young man, forgive me." Guess what? God wants us to start the new year right with Him. And I can't look into anyone's heart. I don't even know my own heart the way I should, but God knows it. And that's the reason these verses remind us that He is longing to have us not just close out the year, but spend every day at the foot of the cross, allowing Him to search our hearts and convict us of things we need to make right between us and Him, things we need to make right with each other, and so that we can be filled with His power, with His joy, and have a year that is led by Him as never before. The good news is that Jesus understands exactly where I'm at. And He knows where you're at. He knows the heartaches that you bear. Maybe you slip into church and you've got a bright smile, but inside your heart is broken. He knows how to mend broken hearts. Maybe you're struggling with a temptation that you just can't say no to, but Jesus understands. He loves you anyway, and He offers the power to be victorious. How do we know that? Let's fast forward several decades. Jesus is no longer the baby in the manger. We're here in Luke 2. Let's back up to Matthew chapter 3. And here we find Jesus now having grown into a strong young man. He feels his Father, his heavenly Father's call to ministry, and he comes to his cousin John the Baptist. And I wish you'd read the whole story, but for the sake of time, let's go to Matthew chapter 3 and verse 17. The Bible says, "Lo, a voice from heaven saying, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased.'" Can you visualize Jesus coming up out of the water and his heavenly Father sending that dove down, and he speaks those words? I'm going back to this December 26th sermon, and I'm quoting, "Many read of this circumstance," Matthew 3:17, we just read it, "many read of it, and do not realize that it particularly concerns them." Can I personalize that? It particularly concerns Ross. Would you personalize it? It particularly concerns Roger, Joe. You plug your name in there. But it is by this proclamation that we may know that Christ is accepted as the, capital B, beloved. And his long arm encircles the human race. That's all of us. While his divine arm grasps the infinite, giving to humanity special power. Does that include Marianne? I should distinguish. Little Marianne, who's not so little anymore, or Grandma Marianne. Is that okay? Giving to humanity special power. What force has this to the race of mankind? Well, the answer is, it means that between heaven is open to the sons and daughters of Adam. All that would avail themselves of the proffered mercy could be saved. I should, straight up, ask for a show of hands. How many of us would like to be saved? We want to go home and spend eternity with Jesus. Oh, what a work this was. It was making a martyr of himself, talking about Jesus. But through Jesus, men are placed where they can become sons and daughters of the Most High. Let the word spoken from heaven, "This is my beloved Son," have an effect upon our hearts. These are precious words. There's a whole lot more that we could look at from that sermon. But let's fast track to Revelation chapter 7. And in Revelation chapter 7, we read some very exciting words. Revelation chapter 7. I want us to get to verse 14, but let's back up to verse 9. In Revelation chapter 7 and verse 9, the Bible says, "After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with what? White robes. Palms in their hands, and cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. If we fast track down to verse 13, one of the elders answered, saying unto me, John's writing, What are these which are arrayed in white robes? And whence came they? And I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, these are they which came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Brothers and sisters, as 2020 closes, I can't scrub my own robe clean. But I can let the blood of Jesus cleanse my heart and make me new. I can ask His power. In fact, let me quote from the sermon once again. Speaking of these white-robed saints in heaven, they were seen in the temple of God. This will be the result for all. That would include Michaela. All who lay hold of the merits of Christ and wash their robes in His blood, every provision has been made so that we can sit with Christ upon His throne. But the condition is that we be in harmony with the law of God. We must forsake all unrighteousness and comply with the conditions. Then all heaven is open to our prayer. How do we get that? Well, let's go to listen to the words of Jesus in John chapter 15. Notice John chapter 15, verse 7. John chapter 15 and verse 7. The Bible says, if ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. The more we talk about Jesus, the more we shall reflect His divine image. By beholding, we become transformed. The more we talk of Jesus, the more of His matchless charms we shall behold. We are not to study the world's standard, but the Word of God. Let us contemplate the great work that has opened a way for our salvation. Brothers and sisters, eternal life is worth everything. We should be willing to sacrifice, for it is worth persevering effort. Everyone can have access to the man of Calvary. He will give us of His Spirit. Can be overcomers through Christ. Do you want to be wrapped in His robe of white righteousness? I think you've heard the story of Jimmy. And every time I hear it, it does something to me. You see, Jimmy's house was made out of tin and cardboard and had been built on the city dump. It was just Jimmy and his mom. She didn't have steady work. Their only light in that little shack was a single candle. And the worst part of it was, yeah, Jimmy lived in a rough neighborhood, but Jimmy had never heard the story of Jesus.
Jesus.
And one day, it's about holiday season, to make a long story short. There's a knock at the door. And a lady, big smile on her face, dressed up for the holidays, asks if she can come in and talk with Jimmy and his mom. And she begins to tell a story about shepherds and wise men and a little baby being born in a manger. And Jimmy's never heard that story before. It's his first time. And his eyes get bigger and bigger the more that's told of the story. He is just soaking up every word. And after she leaves that night, Jimmy snuck out of his bed outside and looked up into the starry sky. And about that time, a neighbor coming home from work said, "Jimmy, what you looking at?" He said, "I'm trying to find that star."
He said, "I'm trying to find that."
He said, "Oh, you're wasting your time. Go back to bed."
He said, "Oh, you're wasting your time."
That lady came
back.
And this time she brought a van or truck or something and loaded up a lot of families from that neighborhood and took them to the mission. And they had a Christmas party that included food baskets and gifts and included a sermon. And this time, as the preacher's telling the Christmas story, he doesn't stop with just the wise men and the shepherds. He goes on to talk about Calvary. And he goes on to talk about how that baby died for our sins after he grew up, and he lived, and he did miracles, and best of all, that baby is coming back as the conquering king. Jimmy's eyes are like saucers. He is soaking up it. He has never heard these stories before. Just out of curiosity, how many of you have heard the story of the shepherds and the wise men and the birth of Jesus? Many, 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 many times. And yet for Jimmy, this was his first time. And he slips up to the front after the service and he says, "Pastor, did I understand you said that Jesus died for me?" This was a new concept to the little fella. And the pastor was like, "Oh, yes, of course. He loves you very much. Did you say that everybody is included?" He said, "Oh, yes, there's nobody left out." Well, Jimmy can hardly contain himself. And the next morning, before breakfast, he knocks on every door in his neighborhood and says a simple question. "Do you know Jesus?" Well, he comes in and his mom's like, "Where have you been? It's time for breakfast." And by now, the snow's falling, the temperatures are crashing, it's a blustery winter day. They have their meal together. And then Jimmy looks at his mom and says, "Up on the hill are a bunch of nice houses. Do you think the people up there know Jesus?" And his mom says, "Oh, I'm sure they do." "But are you sure?" And little Jimmy dashes off into what is now a blizzard and begins to knock on each of those doors. And they'd open the door and he'd say very quickly, "Do you know Jesus?" And if they said yes, then he was gone before they could even hardly shut the door. And yet people realize, here's this little kid, he's got no coat on, he's freezing him, he's starting to shake and turn blue. They're begging him to come in and warm up and he can finish his little missionary errand later. He won't stop, he won't wait. He wants to make sure that everybody on that street knows the same Jesus that he's just been introduced to. And here as he goes, he knocks on one guy's door and he's in a bad mood, but he opens it and says, "What do you want?"
opens it and says,
and when he sees how cold Jimmy is, he begs him to come in. But Jimmy stands right on the doormat and he says, Mister, do you know Jesus? And he says, well, yes, of course I do. Oh, great. And he dashes off. And the guy's calling after him and said, no, you've reached a point. You need to stop and come in and warm up. The problem is he can't catch Jimmy. Jimmy's off into the snow, and they're looking for him. And this guy bundles up, and he goes looking for Jimmy. And finally, by the time he finds him, he's in a snowdrift. And he's not responding. But he gave his all in order to make sure everyone he could find loved Jesus. And brothers and sisters, that touched that man's heart. And it stirred that community. And they said, if we really love Jesus, then we shouldn't have neighbors that are in this state of condition. We need to help them get food and jobs. And as I understand the story, ultimately they built a church where Jimmy's house used to be. And there's a plaque that hangs in that church that asks a simple question. Actually, two. Do you know Jesus? Are you telling others he loves them too? As we close out this year, I want that same dedication Jimmy had. How about you? I can't look into your heart. I don't know if you're best friends with Jesus. You may have been for years. Praise God. He wants to get closer to you than ever before. 2021 can be the best year you've ever had walking with Jesus in a deeper relationship with Him. Just maybe this has been a tough year. And you know you're not right with Jesus, but you'd like to be. All he asked is for us to say two simple words. Yes, Lord. His power will come in and transform us if we say yes, Lord. Father in heaven today, those two words. I want to say to you, yes, Lord. I want everything in my heart to be right with you, but I also want to be available to live your love to others. But I pray that I'm not simply speaking for myself, but for every person here today, Lord. That collectively we say, yes, Lord, to you. We want you to be born in our hearts afresh each and every day. We want to look up with joy when you're coming in the clouds of glory. And Lord, we ask you to help us tell others like Jimmy by the words we speak, by the things we do. We want to honor you. Please take us, for we cannot keep ourselves, and bless us with the power and the courage to be found faithful when you come in the clouds of glory to take us home. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
for that precious baby born so long ago.
But more than that,
thank you for the sacrifice that lived and died and rose again. Thank you that you're coming in the clouds of glory. We ask you to be in our hearts always. As we leave this service, to guide our steps and fill us with your praise every day. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.